This is the BBC.
This podcast is supported by advertising outside the UK.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcast.
You're listening to the TMS podcast from BBC Radio 5 Live.
I'm Jonathan Agnew. Welcome to the TMS podcast, looking back on a thrilling fourth day of the opening test between England and India at Trent Bridge. England have given themselves a chance thanks to a brilliant century from Joe Root, but Bumrah's five wickets have kept India favourites. We'll get the views of Michael Vaughan, Mark Ramprakash and the former Indian player Deep Dasgupta, and we will hear from Root and from Bumrah. Close of play of the fourth day of the first test match between England and India at Trent Bridge sees India on 52 for one. They need a further 157 to win this first test match. They lost KL Rahul in the 14 overs that England could bowl at them in their second innings. He played a nice innings of 26. Sharma, 12 not out. Pujara hit two boundaries in the last over, including four through the covers off the last ball from Robertson. That's a bit of a statement there, and he's back tomorrow also on 12 not out. But it was an absolutely brilliant day's cricket, particularly after tea, in fact. It really came to life, very sparky indeed. A day dominated by Joe Root, who scored his 21st test century, an excellent innings in the conditions. It wasn't easy out there. We know that the ball has tended to dominate in this match. But the smile came back and the jauntiness came back. This was Joe Root at his best once again. And it was a terrific innings, 109 from 172 balls. Burns was out for 18, Sibley for 28, Crawley for 6. At that point, England was still 49 runs behind. Bairstow came out and played positively, put on 42 with Root. Bairstow made 30. That was 177 for 4 when he was caught by Jadeja. He pulled a ball from Serra like a rocket, but straight out to deep square leg where the catch was taken. Lawrence, 25. Disappointed with his dismissal. It's a straight ball, really, that he missed and was LBW. Butler, 17, played no stroke, was bowled by Thakur. Then, excellent innings from Sam Curran, 32 from 45 balls. He lost Root along the way. Robinson, 15 from just 12 balls. Here's the last man out. Stuart Broad got a golden duck, cleaned up by Bumrah, who failed to complete a hat-trick, although he did all but dismiss Jimmy Anderson with a ball that went straight over his off stump. Very quickly indeed. Bumrah finished with 5 for 64, bowled beautifully. Siraj loved him. Real aggression, hostility, spiky. 2 for 84 from 25 overs. Mohammad Shami, 1 for 72. And Shardul Thakur, 2 for 37 from his 13 overs. So, all set to go. Michael Vaughan is alongside me. That's the same to Victor just at the end. If you think of that target as an apple, they've taken quite a big bite out of that.
Yeah, it's a nice chunky bite. How Pujara survived there, I'll never know. He just didn't look in any kind of rhythm or form. A brilliant day for Test cricket. You know, England came out and fought. Little cameos from the likes of Lawrence and Curran. Joss Butler looked good. You know, and then the substance, that test match innings that we've seen from the captain, Joe Root, today, you know, we've seen him score, you know, thousands of test match runs, but, you know, it's always easy to say at the time when you kind of forget of how many great innings he's played, but that was pure, because yeah, his team were under so much pressure, and he knows this batting line just depends on him. As much as he's never going to admit that, but deep down when he walks out, he knows how valuable his wicket is to the team, and the way that he played the seamers and the balance and those cover drives. Then he took after a bit of Jadeja, we know, while he plays the spinners. It was a wonderful innings with a great atmosphere. The crowd are always behind the England team, but in particular Joe Root, because they all know how important he is to this side. You know, I've seen him play great innings in the context of games. I've seen him play great innings, but today it just felt like, you've mentioned, you know, pre-match, you know, you interviewed him two or three days before and you felt that he wasn't quite, you know, his chirpy best. Mm. And it gets you the captaincy, you know, eventually it gets you. And I think it's so important that he plays well and plays in the fact, and plays with that smile. I mean, when you're under that amount of pressure, and when he walked out, his team were so far behind the game, he's still smiling and playing. I think that's when Joe's at his best. He just loves the game of cricket, and that smile is such a great message to all kids, actually, that want to play the game, that even though you're under the utmost pressure, the best way to get the best out of yourself is to enjoy being out in the middle. Mm. And that's exactly what Joe Root looked like he did today.
He did, and he seemed to have lost it a bit. He did look rather careworn. And, of course, those two defeats to New Zealand, I mean, they were poor performances, and there's an awful lot now. These 10 tests we talked about at the start of the game that lie ahead, starting here, ending in Perth in January. Some seriously high-intensity cricket. He's lost Stokes, he's lost Archer, he's lost Stone. It's not easy for him at all. And as you said, to walk out knowing that he has to produce with a bat, and that must, I don't know, how do you cope with that? I mean, in the way that you actually play. I mean, could it make you a bit more tentative in the way that you bat, unless you are just capable of somehow putting it away?
Well, when you mentioned apples, Joe's pretty much the apple of the team, isn't he?
Yeah.
He is the sole batter in this team that you really feel is of high test match class. I mean, 2021, Aggers, he's got over 30% of the team's runs. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
I remember watching the England team when Graham Gooch was captain. Very similar. You always felt like Gooch had to get the big scores, and he's very similar with this England team. And how he can produce that kind of magic and that kind of calmness and that kind of clarity under that amount of pressure, I think it comes down to he knowing his technique. You know, I think if you go back to the New Zealand series, you go back to that last day at Lord's where he didn't chase down that run. I think he didn't chase the runs because he knew that he wasn't in good enough form. Hmm. I think Joe Root playing the way that he's doing now with his technique ironed out against seamers, he may have gone for those runs because he knows he's playing better now. He's worked on his technique. He's stiller. He's not moving as much. His trigger movement's there, but it's not as prominent as we saw against New Zealand. He's not doing that bat swizzle anymore. He's just still.
Yes.
You know, look at Rahul, the way that he's played for India. Still on the release of the ball, still side on, let the ball come. Two pure players. It was a special innings. I've loved today. India are on top. They're the favourites, but you just never know. We've seen this England team before, and we've seen this Indian team in English conditions chasing down this kind of number and losing a few wickets, and they start to panic. You have to say the pitch will probably have to deteriorate somewhat, and it can. It sometimes can happen. The clouds might roll in. The ball starts hooping around, and you feel that for England to win, that possibly will need to happen. But from where they were 2 days ago, England, to where they are now, let's be honest, after day one, the way that they batted, we didn't give them any kind of opportunity to win this game. Mm. And now they've got a little bit of a glimmer because of the captain.
Mark Rambakas joined us today. Not a bad day to come, is it, Mark? I mean, you obviously have seen a lot of Joe Root from your time as England batting coach. He is this bubbly, effervescent character. He is smiley, he's jaunty, he's got a great sense of humour. It just seems to be lacking, but that's more like himself today.
Absolutely. I thought he was back to his fluent best. And I completely agree with Michael. His technique is back to how it was probably 2 years ago. It looks very simple. He goes straight back with his back foot, a light little press on his front foot, and from there, he's very fluid. His transfer of weight is very good. And his mindset, because his mechanics were working well, his mindset of wanting to be busy came back to him.
Yeah.
And there were balls that other players would leave where he was scoring. He has that sort of late cut down to third man. Even when he was defending at the top of off, he can let the ball come to him, slightly open the face and score off good balls. And it makes him very difficult to bowl at. All the shots were there. And I think the message to the team is what's really important. You know, his own form, of course, we rely on him hugely. But the message to the team and to the batting unit, and what is a young batting unit with very little preparation, it has to be said, coming to a test series against a seriously good side. But the message is, look, let's go out and try and be positive wherever we can. If there's scoring opportunity, let's try and take it. And I think that gives these guys, people like Lawrence and Crawley and Sibley, it gives them a bit more direction, a bit more of a firm direction to say, look, this is the way we want to go out and play. Look, it might not come off and we're lacking some senior players, but as a batting unit, let's try and have a purpose when we go out and play.
Michael, where do you think England are with, I don't know, Sibley and Crawley and Lawrence as well, I guess? I mean, you know, whatever happens in the game now, they've had their say. Mm. There's Ollie Pope, who is probably going to be fit for, or could well be fit at least for selection for Lord. There's Hamid, of course, that we've talked a lot about. I mean, where do you think England are with, well, I guess Sibley and Crawley, well, and Lawrence, there's the three of them.
Yeah, I think they've got, I don't think they're tricky decisions. I honestly do. I think they've got to look at the opportunities that those players have had. Crawley, for me, looks like a player. We speak a lot of the time. How big a ceiling do you think Crawley... I think Crawley could be a high-class test match player, but he's not got enough runs. And I just think a player like him, he may be better suited to being out of this environment for a while and just go away. I know there's no four-day cricket, but go away from this environment, go and hit loads of balls, play a bit of the 100, then play some four-day cricket. And the way that he plays, if you can just iron out that technique, he looks to me like his head's falling over a bit. His bat's coming across the line of the ball. So that ball today that he sneaked behind, it's not a great ball. It's a ball that when you're playing well, you should be able to nullify. Mm. Maybe the pressure and the kind of the speculation about his place in the side has got to him. Take him out the firing line. I would take him to Australia, but I wouldn't be picking him for the Lord's Test match. Sibley is probably just done enough, but I look at Sibley and think, how much more are you going to get out of him? You know, he's played a lot of cricket now. You know, and the way that he played today, yes, he nullified an end, but the pitch played quite flat. And I'm just looking at a player that I'm thinking, has he got anything else that he can give? Is there another gear that he could go up to? Mm. And I haven't seen it. And I just feel that at the top of the order, he's always going to be that player that the bowlers are going to be able to dictate to him, even when he gets in. And my concern for him is that when he actually gets in, it almost looks even harder. And that's when you should be going up in the gears and saying, OK, I've had an hour at the crease, all right, I'll go to second gear and I can just manoeuvre the ball into the gaps. He's not been able to do that of late. So I think they'll stick with him. I would bring Hamid in for Crawley. You know my theory on David Milan, but he's not in the squad. But I would have Milan at three and Hamid would end up opening the batting. But that's not the case. Ollie Pope certainly comes in. Darren Lawrence looks a player that has got an eye and a gift to be able to play flamboyant strokes. Has he got the ability to play long innings, which you need in test match cricket? And again, you know, 25 today, played some nice strokes. They were gifted to him on the leg stump, and then he just missed a straight ball.
Yeah.
It's just that technique, I think, against quality. If he really wants to have a prolonged test match career, again, it might be better off taking him out and going to really iron out that technique. Because when he first goes out there, even today, the first 20, 30 ball, you know, you watch and think, you know, if you, you know, because you're running into ball,
sort of scrapping a bit.
You wouldn't mind bowling to that technique early in an inning. So again, these are young players that could come back. England have to make the decision. Don't go on the result of the game. You know, for me, that's irrelevant. Yeah. This has been happening for such a long period of time. I've been making that call, whatever the result of the game is.
Do you sort of get this selection conundrum, Mark?
Absolutely. Yes. Well, when I was involved with the England side, you know. There was always plenty of talk about our batting lineup, you know, over reliance on Joe Root, and lack of top order options, and we're facing the same issues. And of course, you know, it falls on the ECB and the scheduling and the way that the structure of our cricket that we are not producing enough top order options for Test cricket. Is it any wonder that a lot of our young players are gravitating towards white ball cricket and smacking it around rather than having to put the time and effort into to bat long periods of time?
Because there is more time and effort to learn to develop a test match technique.
Yeah.
It is, there is more to put into it than going out there. I know they play some wonderful shots in T20 cricket and they develop skills that way, but to hone that defence particularly.
Yeah, I remember someone asking me, why don't you just tell the test players to go out and bat like the one-day players? And I thought, oh, God, perhaps if we play with a white kookaburra in test cricket, you know, they could play those sorts of shots. But as we know, the red ball moves prodigiously. It has done in this game day one, not so much today. And so that, you're right, Agus, that does take time to hone your technique, to know what balls to play, what balls to attack, what to defend. And concentration is a skill that you have to perfect over time. I mentioned about the preparation of these players coming into a five test series. It's a bit of a shambles, to be honest, in my opinion. And it devalues the test cricket. You know, the integrity of test cricket is under threat, really, through, I think, some of the scheduling. And it's very tough. We're judging these batsmen perhaps very harshly, given the circumstances. Because they are in the glare of international spotlight, up against very good opposition with very little preparation. I really feel for them.
We have to be honest as well, Agus. Just look at the pitch that they played today. And the first thing is it did a bit. So you get bowled out for 180 and you think, you know, you should have got 250. That pitch today played like a 400 wicket. Mm. It was a good pitch. It didn't do a great deal. There was a little bit of movement, not a lot. There was no spin. And because of Joe Root, they've managed to just scrape to 300 just because of the captain with 100. The rest of them really haven't contributed a great deal. And on pitches like this, I would expect a batting lineup to get at least 350, 400 because it didn't do a great deal.
You go outside for TV? Are you going outside now?
I am. I guess, yeah. It looks lovely, doesn't it?
Good luck. It's hammering down.
Mm, lovely.
Michael, let's quickly drop into Heathrow. Deep Dasgupta, you're out tomorrow.
Yes, I am, actually.
Oh, I'm so pleased for you. And it could well coincide with an Indian win. Hey? I mean, you must be confident now.
Yeah, I mean, the way this test match has ebbed and flowed, I wouldn't be surprised if there are a few more twists left on day five.
Did you enjoy that? I mean, that last session after tea, it was proper hammer and tongs test cricket, wasn't it? I mean, real effort from the Indian bowlers, just a bit going on, a bit of snarling going on. Joe Root playing beautifully. It was just one of those sessions that you just want to sort of put a little bottle and put a cork in it and just revisit it every now and then.
I mean, the whole test match, to be honest, Agus, I mean, it's been a great advertisement for test match cricket. There's so much of action happening. You know, we keep talking about T20 cricket and how every delivery is an event in itself. But even this test match, it seemed like every over, every delivery is an event in itself. There's something or the other happening all the time. So, I mean, this has been a really, really good test match so far, all 4 days, except the rain in between and the bad light and all that. But again, Joe Root, what a masterclass, the way he kind of... I mean, it just this shows how good he is or how head and shoulders better than the others that played today. I mean, that was a class act.
Yeah, it certainly was. Andy, is it a stat fest for you
well,
today?
Just to highlight how well Joe Root played and to sort of back up what Michael was saying about the rest of England's batsmen failing to capitalise on good starts. Root's made a half century and a century in this match. It's only the fourth time in the history of Test cricket that a player has made a half century and a century in a match in which none of his teammates have reached 35. So pretty rare occurrence. Only the fifth time an England batsman has made the only two scores over 35 in a test match for his team. And some glittering names prior to Root. David Gower did it in 1983-4 in Pakistan. Peter May and Len Hutton in Ashes Test in the 50s. And a Nottinghamshire great Arthur Shrewsbury way back in the 1880s.
Good old Arthur. Just a last thought from you. I mean, India's batting, getting in the zone, playing in these conditions, chasing a target. You think they'll do it?
They should. Looking at the conditions right now, it's not going to be easy, having said that. And if you look at the India's record, chasing down totals in England isn't that impressive either. So it's not going to be easy. It's going to be challenging against a really, really good bowling side, one of the best in the world in these conditions. It's definitely not going to be easy. And also the Indian middle order hasn't really fired. So someone like Pujara, he would be under pressure. Ajinkya would be under pressure to score some runs in this inning. So yeah, I mean, it's going to be another very, very interesting day of Test match cricket.
Thanks, Deep. Well, let's get some reaction now. And as the rain fell at the close of play, Simon Mann spoke to Joe Root.
Well, Joe, let's start with the innings first up. 21 test hundreds. You've got a lot to pick from, but how highly would you rate that?
I thought I played quite nicely today, actually. I felt quite fluent. I felt like I got my rhythm back, something I've been struggling with for a while. It's felt pretty good throughout this whole game. So I think more than anything, it was just nice to get as it back into the contest and feel like we've got some runs at least to play with going into the final day.
It's been quite a tough summer for you and the team. Did you sort of get some of your joy back today?
Yeah, I mean, that was one thing I spoke to the group about this morning, was about enjoying batting and just remembering how fun it is to go out there and score runs on probably the best stage for it as well. You know, you can't beat playing test match cricket. My opinion, it's the pinnacle of the game. And with a great crowd, a great atmosphere, to just go and embrace that, enjoy that, and just remember, you know, why you started playing the game. You know, go and enjoy scoring runs and doing it at the highest level.
Did you come out with a positive mindset? Was that, you know, something you set yourself to do?
More than anything, it was just trying to just react. Knew on this wicket that if you let bowlers just bowl at you, then it's going to make it almost harder. It's trying to be proactive, and when you got opportunities to score, to really look to take them. So more than anything, it was just trying to get the balance between keeping out the good ones and punishing the bad ones. And if you can rotate the strike as well, have a couple of good balls, then feel like you're always had a chance of making it difficult for the bowlers.
Did you feel you didn't quite get enough support from the other end? You did get support from the other end, but not the big scores that would have set India a really challenging total.
I mean, I think more than anything, we look at the 200. It would be nice to have 250 to play with today going into the final day. But you've seen on this wicket throughout the whole game, there's been clusters. And I think more than anything, we've got to go into tomorrow with a lot of belief, play with that enjoyment, and, you know, throw everything at India. Give ourselves the best chance of winning this game. And know that on that surface, there is still a lot of movement there, and I don't think that's going to change throughout. So it's really important that we just give ourselves the best opportunity by being relentless with the areas that we bowl, asking really good questions, and trying to make every run count, you know, making it, taking it as deep as we can, and really putting pressure on that way.
So you feel there are 9 wickets out there?
Yeah, I think certainly if we bowl well enough, we have a little bit of luck. I think we're going to have to, a few things going to have to fall our way, but you know, it can easily happen. Final day of the game, get a couple of early wickets tomorrow. It does change the whole outlook of the situation.
Well, we got to the end of the interview and the rain has stopped, which is typical. Thanks very much for your time. Well played today.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Simon.
That's Joe Root with Simon Mann, who also spoke with the India fast bowler, Jasprit Bumrah.
Well, Jasprit, well bowled. Second best figures of your Test match career. How did you enjoy bowling out there?
It was very good. Today, when we started our innings, when we started to bowl, there was not a lot of help. So we were focusing on trying to create pressure, but we realized that as soon as we get one, then we could, you know, jump onto the momentum, and then the ball would start to swing. So then we would look to capitalize. But that happened in the second new ball. Till then, we didn't get a lot of swing with the older ball. We gave away a few boundaries which we didn't want to, but this is how the game of cricket goes.
It all came well in the end, didn't it? Because there were moments when England were forging ahead.
So we were looking at the scenario that if we take 2 wickets quickly, we were just telling ourselves that add 2 wickets to the total and then you're back into the game. So we were telling ourselves that. In patches, when you're bowling with the old ball, the wicket look like a different wicket. As soon as the ball starts to swing, it looks like a different wicket. So we were just waiting for that one opportunity. As soon as we get that, so then we can jump in.
Did you feel the crucial moment of the day, in a way, was the new ball and getting Joe Root?
Yeah, he played very well. I got his edge in the morning as well, but he didn't carry. So he got some thick edges, but he played really well. Nothing, not taking away the credit at all. He applied himself, played the captain's knock. So yeah, good on him.
You've been a bit short of Test match wickets recently. You didn't take any in the World Test Championship final. Did you feel confident coming into this game?
One game is just one game. I was not too short of wickets. In Australia, I had a good time as well. Didn't play a lot in India. But I was not looking at the end result too much. I was just trying to be in the moment, try to replicate the things that has worked for me and try to believe in myself. So I was trying to make the process a little simple. So rather than looking at the end pictures, you could sometimes, you know, go ahead of the game. So I was trying to do that.
One final question. How do you see the state of the game?
Really happy. We've got a good start. Hopefully tomorrow early morning we'll look to capitalise on it and hopefully take it from there, session by session.
Thanks very much. Well bowled.
Cheers. Thank you.
That was Jasprit Bumrah with Simon Mann. Now, there are plenty of other podcasts to look out for on this stream, including a fascinating chat with Michael Holding and our view from the boundary guest, the actor Nigel Boyle, also known as H from Line of Duty. He told me what it was like to be at the centre of a massive TV drama storyline and how a contact with Ian Bell has helped him get into cricket.
He's actually invited me to play in a charity cricket match at Dorridge Cricket Ground.
Oh, and that could be interesting.
Yeah, well, it could be really interesting for me.
What are you going to do? Bat or bowl? Or
certainly going to bat. Right. Certainly, certainly.
Have you had a go?
Yeah, well, my mate Pritch has got a bowling machine in his garden in Stukeley, so I've hit a couple of sixes.
Have you?
Yeah. I mean, there might be more baseball than cricket, but...
That's all right. That's totally forgivable. If you see that in the 100, lots of those sort of shots going on.
Exactly. This is what you've got to do, isn't it? But one thing that I would say is that having experienced Edgbaston, Lords and now Trent Bridge and stuff, I think the atmosphere of the crowd and the Barmy Army that they can bring is also an added strands of the game, and I think it's crucial, and that's why I'm so happy that things are opening up now and we can you know, get crowds involved. I'm just praying that it stays like this. Yeah. I went to the toilet earlier and I heard a big roar. I go, oh, what have I missed?
So come on then, let's stick you back into role here, or at least talking about this fellow Buckles, who just had us dangling, really. The call comes from Jed Mercurio, of all things. He says, right, Nigel, I've got a bit of news for you here. It's
well,
you.
Yeah, so we were, going back to that, we were on a hiatus due to COVID, and we were due to start shooting in the next week or two. So I get a text from Jed, and I was like, oh goodness, why am I getting a text from Jed? And he said, are you free for a chat today? Don't worry, it's not that cool.
Oh, right, okay.
It's not that cool. I was like, goodness, okay, it's not that cool, but why does he want to talk to me? What have I done wrong? Am I in trouble? Have I done something? And So I text straight back and said, yeah, that's fine. And he calls me straight away and he said, I just wanted you to be the first to know. We're going to release the final two episodes of the series. And you're going to be revealed as someone quite significant. And I was like, right, okay, I know what that means. And he said, yeah, so I just wanted to let you know. And don't let that change your acting performance. But you'll see from the scripts what's going to happen.
Which is easier said than done, I would guess, given you've got an idea now of how it's... So by release, you mean that you get your scripts, so everyone involved sees how it's going to go.
Yeah, for sure. So later that day, everyone was emailed the scripts.
Yeah.
So straight away, I'm straight into reading my scenes and, oh my goodness. So, and it's great. It was lovely. I was buzzing, absolutely, really excited for it, and I couldn't wait to get back to Belfast to do it.
That's Nigel Boyle, and you can hear the full interview on this stream. Now, you can watch highlights of the dramatic fourth day at Trent Bridge on the BBC iPlayer or via the website and app, and we're back on air for the fifth day from 10:15.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.